today's program is about coffee, that beverage that millions of people use to kick off their day. How can you buy more wisely? How can you make a better cup of Joe? And a lot more. Please stay tuned.
Get all your money back from your grocer without argument. Special for Movie Week, only 28 cents a pound, plus 3 cents refundable deposit on the jar.
Welcome to The Better Part, a program by and for seniors, and devoted to exploring the many facets of those better years.
Hello, I am Phil Linehan of The Better Part, your host for this program. Today's guest is Jared Carlson, owner of the Roasted Coffee Bean in Cupertino. Jared brings to us 25 years of coffee experience and will share with us his wisdom and many facets of this subject. Welcome, Jared.
Thank you, Phil. It's a pleasure to be here and on your show. I hope that today we'll be able to pass on some things for your viewers to use to get a good cup of coffee at home.
Well, let's start with basics.
Okay.
What is coffee?
Coffee. Coffee is the pit of a coffee cherry. It's not much larger than a cranberry. And many people have the misconception that by calling it a coffee bean, it's really not a bean. It's actually the pit of the cherry. And the pit is covered by different layers, the skin, the pulp, and so forth, which is removed to get down to this cherry pit to be able to make it into that beautiful brown cup of coffee in the morning.
All right, what is the difference between commercial coffee and specialty coffee?
Your specialty coffee is usually the quality coffees that most people seek in having a good cup of coffee. Your commercial coffees, on the other hand, are more in the line of mass production, finding the grocery stores to satisfy the needs of the larger population. And these particular coffees don't necessarily always have the quality that the specialty or gourmet coffees offer.
What are the names of these two varieties of coffees that fall into these categories?
Basically, there is two categories. There's the Robusto and the Arabica. Now, your Robusto bean is a lesser quality bean. It is grown in larger quantities and it's cheaper. Where your more flavorful quality bean is the Arabica, and it's grown at a higher altitude, grows slower, and it gives more flavor and richness to your cup of coffee.
And looking at a map of where coffee is grown, I noticed that it's in a band around the equator. Why does it need that type of climate?
Yes, coffees grow better in a more humid jungle type climate, yet at the same time, they do not require a lot of great direct sunlight. Too much sunlight and the leaves become weak and the trees can slowly produce fewer beans that the coffee plantation needs.
What does altitude have to do with the coffee also?
Well, seemingly at the higher altitudes, you get the better quality coffee. It has a climate that lends itself to soil conditions, weather conditions, cloud conditions that give you the better quality Arabica bean.
Okay, now starting with the grower, how is coffee processed?
Well, first of all, coffee is a highly intense labor crop. It's basically hand-picked, and because of the reason it's hand-picked, the coffee tree will produce ripe cherries, green cherries, and blossoms at the same time. Once they're picked, they're taken to a hauling center where the pulp is removed and you get down to the pit. Then the pits are dried, sacked, then moved on to shipment to wherever in the world.
So does that mean that a grower or somebody taking the coffee off the tree has to go back multiple times because it's not all ripe at the same time?
That's correct. There's no way for him to be able to pick all the cherries at one picking to get a quality cup of coffee for the customer. Green beans, blossoms do not add to the flavor. What you need is that red cherry.
How do they get all the stuff off the outside of the pit or the bean?
Basically, there are two ways. There's the dry method and there's the wet method. Basically, the dry method is just putting the coffee cherries out on what they call a patio. It's a large concrete slab, and let the sun dry them out, and then they put them into haulers or the barrel turns and removes the pulp. Wet method, they soak the cherry in a water solution, and the cherries soak up the water and split, and therefore they are able to put them into the hullers and remove the pulp that way.
In my reading, I found that coffee is as complicated as wine in its flavor. So could you review just a little bit of some of the flavors that we should be considering when we're buying coffee or testing coffee or thinking of changing the coffee we have?
Well, coffees take on characteristics in regions that they grow. Coffee is indigenous from Yemen and Ethiopia. So when these coffee trees were moved to other regions like Indonesia, South America, India, Africa, they took on their characteristics from the soil and the growing season. So what you have now is coffees that can offer you a light body, light taste, like Santos from Brazil. You can get coffees that have a rich, full body, smooth taste, something like from Celebes from Indonesia. Also in Indonesia you have Java, which is a coffee that is light in taste and has a light body. So when looking at your coffees and buying the coffees, there's a wide choice of characteristics you can get from a cup of coffee. If somebody enjoys something with more fullness and richness, they want to go to something like a Celebes, Arabian Mocha. Something lighter might be a Colombian, Brazil, Costa Rican.
So you now have a uniqueness of where it was grown. Now the next process you have is roasting it. And I looked on my list of roastings. There was five or six categories of roasting. In my notes, I have cinnamon roast. How does that affect? I'll just read these off and you can comment on them.
Okay.
So we start with cinnamon roast.
Okay, first of all, must understand that roast varies from one roasting company to another. There is no rules or regulations as to what differentiates. When you look at a cinnamon roast, this is basically your lightest roast of coffee. And it'll give you a coffee that doesn't have maybe always the richness and fullness that you would seek from that particular bean. And also, the cinnamon roast makes it so that there's not as much evaporation of moisture from the bean itself. Because during a roasting cycle, coffee beans can lose up to 14% of their weight in roast.
Okay, do you roast anything that light?
No, I don't. My pursuit of roasting coffee beans in my establishment is what I would call basically an optimum roast. And that means I'm trying to bring out the very flavor that the bean itself has to offer. I don't want to under roast it, and I don't want to over roast it. You start getting into those areas and you start adding different nuances to the bean. And then you rob the customer of an opportunity of what the true taste and flavor that the bean has to offer.
Okay, our next roast is American roast.
American roast, it's a darker roast than the cinnamon. It's not quite what I use for my roasts. It's not that optimum roast.
Okay, full city roast.
Full city roast, now you're starting to get into a coffee bean that's starting to take on that darker, richer color, darker brown. That's about where I roast my beans.
Okay, and the Vienna roast?
Vienna roast is one of the dark roasts. And when you start doing dark roast, you start adding different characteristics to the flavor. Because the bean starts at this point to become carbonized.
And the French roast?
French roast is usually your darkest roast that you will find on the market. And it definitely has reached a point of starting to carbonize the coffee bean. The coffee then will take on a sharper, a stronger taste.
And the Italian roast?
Italian roast. You won't find that in many establishments, but it is a roast that has carbonized the bean, and it definitely will be very strong, sharp-tasting coffee.
So like little pieces of coal?
To a degree, yes, it is. I mean, they just really roasted the bean to its max before it does turn into charcoal.
Okay, I noticed across the various roasts, some are dull and some are shiny. How does it pick up the shine on the bean?
Okay, coffee beans contain oils. And the darker the roast, the more oil comes to the surface of the bean. You go and look at a French roast, and you'll notice that it's very shiny, lots of oil. You look at something like the Full City, or what I call Optimum Roast, and you'll find most of the beans are dry because there hasn't produced that much oil to the surface.
Does that remove the oil or just place it out on the surface?
It places it on the surface. It does nothing in regards to actually removing oil from the coffee bean.
Okay, so you roast your own coffee, correct?
That is correct, Phil.
So I took your class, so I watched the roasting process. So could you just walk us through what you did in that class and how you wound up roasting that batch of coffee for us that night?
Okay. My roaster, first of all, is what they call small batch roasting. And that means that you usually do about, like my roaster, 30 pounds at a time. This gives you an opportunity to roast very frequently and have very fresh beans available. You set the temperature for the roaster, and the kind of roaster I have is fluidized. It uses hot air as opposed to a tumble roaster as the barrel roasters are. And once you've set the temperature, you measure out the 30 pounds, you put them into the chamber, start the roasting cycle, and it goes through this normal cycle. Once the temperature is reached, the roaster automatically shuts down and pursue cooling the beans. This actual cycle takes about 6 minutes, and once these roasted beans have become cool enough, we remove them from the chamber, run them through another cooling cycle, and the beans are now ready to be sold.
And they go from green to brown.
That is correct. You actually go watch through a small window and watch them going green, tan, dark tan, and then that wonderful brown roasted bean.
And some people in the class were surprised that they were green to begin with.
Yes, they were. Many people are so used to going to the grocery store and buying brown coffee or brown beans, they never have any idea that you start off with green.
Okay, what is the, so we've now roasted the coffee, and how long will it stay fresh?
Whole beans will stay fresh for approximately 30 days. After they've been roasted. If you grind the beans, then that reduces the length of life of freshness, and that brings it down to about a week. And one way that I try to encourage my customers to help prolong the freshness is to actually put the beans or the grounds in a container in the freezer, and it will give it an extra week or an extra month on the whole beans.
So you should really watch your coffee consumption cycle and stay within that freshness window.
That's true. That's true. I try to find out from my customers how quickly they can go through a half a pound or a pound of beans or a half a pound or a pound of grounds. And I recommend at that point, should you get more, should you get less, so that you've always got good fresh coffee.
When I chatted with my friends that I was going to be doing a coffee program, one of the most often asked questions is, how do you get the caffeine out of the beans? And what are the processes, and are there all kinds of nasty chemicals left behind, or is this healthy or what? So give us a comment on that process.
Okay, caffeine is soluble in numerous chemicals. Formaldehyde is one of them, methylene chloride is another. And yes, these chemicals in and of themselves are harmful, but the residue that is left on the bean and when after the bean has been roasted is reduced to such small amounts that it's hardly noticeable, and therefore it is not an endangerment to the person's health.
We had one of the elements that I read vaporizes at 104 degrees and you're roasting at 450?
Yes.
So I guess it doesn't stay around very long.
No, it does not.
What is the difference between the two types of coffee and the caffeine content?
Well, in decaffeination process, you reduce about all the caffeine except for about 3%. And of course, in a regular coffee bean that has not been decaffeinated, you have 100% of whatever there is.
Mm-hmm. Is the Robusta coffee bean have more caffeine than the Arabica?
It does. For some reason, the cheaper bean does get more caffeine in its development of growth as opposed to the Arabica.
So if you want to cut down on your caffeine, just switch the styles of coffee and go to the gourmet coffee or the specialty coffee.
Yes.
Okay. What do they do with the caffeine that they take out?
Well, one of the things they do with it, and some people are not really fully aware of this, your aspirins or your cold remedies, read on the label. It'll say sometimes caffeine, and that's where the caffeine goes, into your medications. And so therefore, trying to escape these chemical solutions, because they take them from the solutions, you get them in your medicine.
Ah, so they get us one way or another. Okay, now I go into a coffee shop and I look at the menu board and I don't understand what all these coffees are. So could you walk us down the list of just few of the more popular mystic French and I was going to say German, but it is not German, French and Spanish names of the coffees and the drinks.
Okay. Some of the more noted ones are things like a café au lait. Really what you're doing here is taking regular house coffee and adding hot milk to it and to the proportions you want. In something like a café latte, you are actually involving making a shot of espresso and then adding hot milk to that. In coffees like a café mocha, you substitute hot chocolate for the hot milk and mix it with espresso. One of the interesting ones that I like is cappuccino. Now, to make a cappuccino, you have to froth the milk, and then you take the froth, lay it on top of the espresso, and you have yourself a cappuccino.
What is espresso?
Espresso. Okay. Sometimes people feel that espresso is a particular coffee bean. It is not. You can actually use any coffee bean you wish to make espresso. Espresso is actually a way of brewing coffee. Like a percolator, like a drip machine, like a French press. It's a method of brewing coffee. The Italians came up with it around the turn of the 20th century because they were trying to establish making a single cup of coffee quickly. And that's where the word espresso comes from.
So it's a quick way to get your shot of caffeine.
That's it.
Okay, well, what would you suggest to people? Should they buy beans or should they buy ground coffee?
Well, I always try to encourage beans if customers have their own coffee grinders because beans do stay fresh longer. And when you grind it just before you brew your coffee, you definitely get a good fresh cup of coffee. On the other hand, there is the convenience of the beans already being ground up and you don't have to deal with grinding and cleaning a grinder. You can go right ahead and brew the coffee immediately. But in that case, I always try to make sure that they will use the grounds within approximately a week because I warn them these grounds, after a week, will start losing their flavor.
Jared, now I have all these wonderful beans and they're all roasted. What kind of a grinder should I be using to prepare them for my coffee pot?
There's two basic grinders that are on the market people use. There's an inexpensive grinder, which is not really a grinder. It's a blade method, which people are familiar with when doing chopped nuts for cakes and pies and things like that. And it's just a blade that goes round and round and round, and it keeps cutting up the beans until they get down to the size you want. Unfortunately, no uniformity. The other kind of coffee grinder, which is a little more costly, runs probably around $70, $80, is a burr grinder. And this allows the beans to pass through one time at a setting that the burrs are put at to grind the beans. What's great about this is the fact that you've got consistency of the grind. All the grinds are of the same size. Therefore, you get a good brew, where with the impact blade style, the blade being that it doesn't grind everything equally, you can get a poor brew out of your coffee.
How does water quality affect the flavor of coffee?
Well, if the water flavor that you have coming from your water tap seems to be off, maybe minerals or chemicals, this will affect your flavor of your coffee because it'll show up in the drink itself. Some areas in Santa Clara County, the water is extra hard, and this can create a difference in your flavor of your coffee. So sometimes I tell my customers, if you find the water's off in taste, get spring water at the store and use that to make your coffee with.
All right. What are the many methods of making coffee? I'm told that percolating is not the best method.
Yes, you're right, Phil. Percolators, they have their purpose when you're having large parties and you need something of 30 or 50 cups being made up at a time. But a percolator just re-boils the coffee. The water goes through the grounds, then goes through the grounds again, goes through the grounds. It just keeps cooking it. You have other methods which I think do a lot better. Your drip method, which is most popular, which the water drips through a filter, is great. Another method is a French plunger pot, which I like to use because the water and the coffee bloom at the same time. And therefore, you have really good control of how strong you want your coffee. And you're assured of getting all the essence and flavor from the coffee you want.
On the press method, I have a press, but the coffee gets cold so quickly.
Well, a coffee press, they're not really made to retain the heat for any length of time. Because once you have brewed your coffee, and that only takes a few minutes or less, you have to really pour it then. There are some presses out which, instead of using a glass beaker, they use a double-walled stainless steel beaker. And this will keep the coffee hotter longer. But still, in a press, you should serve it at the time it's ready and not think that you can go back in 15 or 20 minutes and pour another cup, because by then it starts to get cold.
What about the use of a carafe?
Carafes are good for serving coffee, especially for when you're serving guests and you don't want to keep going back and forth to the coffee maker. They are insulated. They're usually double-walled. As I pointed out, the French plunger pot with a double wall keeps the coffee hot longer. But don't expect it to maintain its heat for a great length of time. Maybe 30 minutes, and then you might want to brew another fresh carafe of coffee.
But isn't it a good idea to get the coffee off the heat from your drip machine and just keep it hot on something else rather than keeping applying heat to it?
True, because as long as it's on a heat source, it just keeps cooking. After about a half hour, 45 minutes, you might start seeing a change in the flavor of the coffee.
So it's good for at least a half an hour safely on the heat of your drip machine.
Correct.
All right, what about espresso machines? Why does an espresso machine cost $300 and a Mr. Coffee cost $18.50 at a discount store?
Well, you are looking at a whole different type of coffee makers. Your espresso machines are usually made up with boilers, or what they call a pour over, and it must heat the water and retain the heat and the pressure so that you can shoot the steam through the grounds. Now, with a Mr. Coffee style, you're just basically pouring the water in. It heats up instantly through an orifice that heats up the water and passes the water through to the filter. And therefore, you're not retaining any pressure in a machine that will require you to make the espresso.
Are there other methods for making espresso, like on the stovetop, rather than having a $300 machine?
Yes, stovetop espresso machines do a great job. I use one in myself, and I have a lot of my customers who are from Italy. When they see them on our shelves there for sale, they say, oh yes, this is what we do at home. It makes a great espresso. You put it on the stovetop. That takes less than 5 minutes to make a number of cups of espresso with it. And they're relatively inexpensive to the $300 to $500 or some odd dollar home espresso machines.
Will the stovetop give you la crema on the top?
It can do that. It can do that. I've known from experience when I've made it, I do get the crema.
Okay, I'm going to try that when I get home. All right, tell us about your class at the Amza College.
About 4 or 5 years ago, I was approached by De Anza College to put together a class on coffee. And I submitted a small digest of what we could do, and I geared my class toward helping people know how to get a good cup of coffee. The water, the grind, the coffee makers, all of these things that will eventually, in the morning when they pour a cup of coffee, say, this is a good cup of coffee.
And how long does the class take?
It's a 2-hour evening class. First hour, I give a lecture on quality of coffee. The second hour, we then proceed to do a coffee tasting. This is not to find out what is the best flavored coffee, but to show the people the differences between one cup of coffee and another. And then we end up the evening by actually doing a coffee roast, so the people get a real idea of what the process of going through of green beans to the roasted beans.
How could I taste test coffee?
Well, there are a number of ways. You can actually go out and buy small amounts of coffee yourself and brew up several cups. One thing that we do at my place of business is, because we offer a number of different coffees for the day, I always encourage customers to please sample what there is out there. This way they get an opportunity to compare one against the other. And because they're changed every day, there's always some new coffee for them to try.
So if I keep coming into your shop, I could, over a month, have many, many different types of coffee that I could compare.
Correct.
All right. We've just about run out of time right now. Is there anything else that you would like to add? Any thoughts from your customers or anything?
Well, one thing I want to really put forth, and this I think is really important, because you can go through all the right steps, the right grinder, the right water, the right coffee maker and everything, but the freshness of the coffee beans or grounds you buy. If they're not fresh, you're not going to get a good cup of coffee. One thing you want to do is smell the beans or smell the grounds. If you can smell an aroma, they're still fresh enough to make a pot of coffee. Or have a coffee purveyor that you go to keep you in mind of what's his freshest roast that he's got for the day.
Well, I'd like to thank you, Jared, for joining us, and I'm sure our listeners know a lot more about coffee now than when they started, and I learned a lot getting ready for this program and the conversation that you and I have had. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Phil.
We hope you have enjoyed today's adventure into the world of coffee. Jared can be reached at the Roasted Coffee Bean in Cupertino at 408-725-1919. Jared's class at De Anza College is listed in the Foothill De Anza College Community Education Short Form Catalog. For more information on coffee, check your local library or the internet. The book I used today to prepare for this program is called Coffee, and it's by Kenneth Davids. There is also a great PBS series on the socioeconomic impact of coffee called Black Coffee. It should be available from your local video rental source. Thank you for watching, and we'll see you next time on The Better Part. And enjoy that cup of coffee.
Thank you for joining us. We hope that you found today's program both informative and interesting. If you would like to suggest a topic or a guest for The Better Part, you can always reach us at the Cupertino Senior Center. The number there is 408-777-3150. You can learn more about us and order a copy of this program or one of the many programs that we've done by visiting our website. The website address is www.thebetterpart.com. The Better Part has many of its programs available through the Santa Clara County Library System. And The Better Part has selected programs also on YouTube. Thanks again for watching. See you next week.